this was a good idea.
That works.
Sit.
Are we good?
Sit.
Yeah. All right, guys. Well, this is the What I Know About Your Company Hacking LinkedIn Business Processes. So if you're looking for the other talk, it's over there. Or if I'm not pretty enough, you guys can go ahead and leave without hurting my feelings. But we'll go ahead. I wanted to actually get a volunteer here to throw out like a company name. I may kick off a scan so we could look at it later. And do they have more than like 10 employees?
They have a few.
A few? All right, what is it?
Florida Angel Nexus.
Angel Nexus. These guys?
Yeah, I think so. Yep, that's them.
All right, we're going to do a little preview here. All right, so that was Florida Angel. What was the last part?
Nexus.
Current. And how big, let's see, do they have a sales team? One result. Let's do a little bigger. I mean, I could do that, but let's
host
get
on,
huh?
Host on web host.
Okay, host.
Dime.
Host Dime. Okay, let's do that. Okay. Okay, so we'll do host Dime, and let's see if they have a significant sales team here. Nine. That's doable. I mean, we could do that. Would they have a bigger, like, they won't have a security staff, would they?
Some. 10 people.
We'll start with this, okay? We'll run this, and if we want to do some more. So, let's see here. And that was host Dime. Okay, host. And you don't need to see this. I'll zoom in when I'm actually, like, demoing these things. So, I just want to get this started. You're still on Wi-Fi. All right, we're good. Okay, 9 people. Mm-hmm. And then profiler. Let's do host Dime. All right, we'll let that run. That actually won't take that long, but that's cool. Okay, so we're gonna go. So yeah, this is Hacking LinkedIn. One, you want? Oh, I guess I could delay. Are you guys cool with a delay?
And
okay.
So you will get more.
Oh, okay. Who gave host time? Was that you? Okay, we're throwing out alcohol, so there you go. All right. Okay, good deal. I have a little bit more alcohol left, so. Give it 3 minutes, and I'll, okay. We can do that. What? I'm fine. Yeah, I will. Well, they're not gonna miss much in the beginning, so we'll keep going. All right, we will continue. So, all right. So I'll give a little bit about myself. I'm Danny Chrastil, and I like to hack stuff, which hopefully most of you guys do too. My past life, I was in web dev. So I was doing a lot of web dev, you know, Linux sysadmin and database administration. So that was kind of my background, but I've always liked to hack stuff. And so even as like a kid, let's see, who remembers like Netbus? Do you guys play Netbus? Okay, good. Not dating myself too much, but Netbus was fun because I was, say, junior high. And I'd go to my friend's house and we'd be hanging out. While we're there, I'd like crack open his garage door just like a couple feet. This is really bad, but later I would come to his house when nobody was there and I'd like roll under and go up to his computer with my floppy disk and install my Netbus client and, you know, go home. And later, like a few days later when we're on AOL together, I would fire up like my Netbus client, and I'd like start opening and closing his like CD-ROM drive and like popping up messages like the Matrix has found you, you know, stuff like that, and just poking around and having fun. But you know, that's just like the fun stuff we like to do when you're younger. And it wasn't till later when I was like, you know what, I could actually like turn my career and like start hacking things for my job. That sounds awesome. And that's when I dropped web dev like a bad habit, and I was like, okay, yeah, let's go start hacking. And so now I do pen testing with an emphasis on web tech. So I do a lot of web pen and recon and R&D type stuff. I work for HP, Fortify On Demand, and I don't even have that on here, but that's all right. So we're going to be talking about recon. So a lot of stuff I've been doing has been at HP is kind of web pen, but also doing this R&D, which is scripting a lot of stuff, which is based on reconnaissance. So that's kind of been my focus for a long time. So it's been a fun thing to focus on. And if you were in at Jonathan's talk just last, he really plugged me well when he was saying, like, reconnaissance is awesome and you have to do it right. Were you guys in? Who was here for Jonathan's talk last? Okay, yes, I support his statement there because it is awesome. But a lot of us, we think it's boring and tedious and checkmark of just what we need to do for our pen test. So who here does pen testing of some sort? Web, net pen? Okay, cool. Now, who does recon for your pen testing? Okay, so good deal. So recon is like such an awesome part because it's really that step you need to be able to perform an even better test. And if you're not doing it, then tisk on your company and on yourself. Now, I won't be too hard on you, but it is boring. And sometimes we get in this like, I don't want to do it. I just want to skip to like popping shells and like doing some, you know, social engineering with my cross-site scripting, you know, findings, all that kind of stuff. And we don't pay attention to this. So what do we got to do? We need to make it sexy, right? Like Angelina Jolie doing it on the awesome movie Hackers. So how do we do that? And before I kind of dive into this, this isn't going to be like this full recon workshop on what you need to do for your pen tests or for your physical assessments. I'm not going to get into like everything you need to do, but I want to take some topics of reconnaissance and turn them into from this boring thing into like an awesome fun thing. So what are some things that we do in recon? There's different types. We have like business intelligence. So let's say, you know, this is my target competitor and I want to find out who they're selling to, because that's who I'm going to target and I may try to steal business from them. You know, there's one perspective of business intel. But really figuring out what this company does, you know, what's sensitive to them, what information am I going to try to hack and what am I going to try to steal from them. So then other things like, okay, well, do these guys have like uniform email formats? Like it's always firstname.lastname@saidcompany.com. You know, this is all the business intel you're going to gather. Then we have network mapping. So if you don't know Nmap, go learn Nmap. That's, you know, basic for our network mapping. But really, you can't do that unless you've already gotten what IP addresses belong to the target, right? So if you don't know that, I mean, you need to do some recon to figure out what IP spaces do these guys own. Now DNS recon, all right? Let's see, you know, what domain names do these guys own? What kind of name servers? Do they own their own name servers? Do they have AREC or MX records that are pointing like Exchange servers? So now they're using Exchange email. That's some DNS recon. And then fingerprinting. So now we have like a huge list of IP addresses. We have, you know, domains, all this kind of stuff. Well, let's fingerprint them. Let's see what kind of applications are running on those. Are they CMSs? Do they have e-commerce? What kind of like libraries are they using? Is it jQuery, et cetera? You know, with our IP addresses, what IP addresses are responding in those ranges? What's on those ports? What, you know, what software and what versions running on those ports and so forth. So that's our recon. So I'm going to jump in here to a few tools that I like. Get my video going. A few tools that I like, and I'm going to show like how this tedious stuff could really be cool. So ARIN, if you haven't seen this before, this is your American Registry for Internet Numbers. Basically a fancy way of just logging IP addresses for a public record of IP addresses for companies. So if I target Hewlett Packard, you know, we get a whole bunch of stuff. You could click on one and, you know, they have network resources. And if we go into that network resource, you'll see, oh, here's an IP range that they own. Cool. Let's add that to our file for doing recon. Well, let's do like Sony. You know, we like to pick on Sony. So here's some IP addresses for Sony. Let's open up this customer record, a network resource. Right. Okay. Well, we got some more. But the thing is, there's usually tons of these, right? So we don't want to have to go through each one and be like, okay, I got to copy that and paste it to our notepad or whatever you're using. So how about we automate it? How about I grab HP's ARIN handle here? So I'm going to grab HP 30 in this case. There's more than just one. But I may take this, I may load up a little script that I wrote here. So I like Python. So this is a get IP ranges, which has a few arguments here. We have org ID and like a pattern to check it, right? So we're going to go ahead and run this. I'll put in my HP, I think you do 33, but it doesn't matter. And then Hewlett for my pattern to match. So it's going to run, do its magic, and wait for it. Yeah. All right, so now we just got a huge list of all these IP addresses that are on the ARIN record. And a lot of these are actually owned by HP, so with some large blocks as well. So like now we have a whole bunch of data, what we got in a matter of seconds or a minute or two, and could throw that into Nmap. You know, throw that into your Nessus scanner. You know, now you have some real data to start working with. Here's another one. Okay, so who is? This is basic, right? So we'll start off with a little who is search. Let's do a who is on hp.com and see what comes up. All right, so here's their who is record, and they own their own name servers, believe it or not. So let's take their name servers, right, and go to this cool service. Now this is GWeb Tools, and there's tons of these all over the place. But this is one that I really like. And specifically, they have this thing called Name Server Spy. So they have their own database where they record all these domains that belong to specific name servers. So if I do a search here for ns1.hp.com, let's see what we get. All right, we have 1,510 domains that are under that name server. And so you can see there's a lot and a lot of pages. So 13, it just keeps going. And I do not want to copy and paste the domains off of this this tool. And so there's 61 pages, so that's what I just showed. And so how are we going to get it? I mean, they have an API. You could pay to use their API, but I mean, we're hackers, and if we do that for every tool we use, we're going to be broke, right? So let's figure out how to do it without. So I have another tool here, and this is written in Python. So we have our GWeb scraper, okay? So all we have to pass in is our name server and how many pages were in the results. So let's do this. I may do ns1.hp.com. Oh, I gotta do name servers. ns1.hp.com, and I know that the pages are 61. So if we hit enter, there we go. 1,510 domain names that have at one point been under the ns1.hp.com name server. And yeah, you're going to have some few false positives in there because this isn't always up to date, or they could be old records, but this is some great information, right? All right, so I may show one more, and this is very similar. So what if they don't have their own name server, okay? So hp.com, I'm going to do this again. It does have their own name server. But what other kind of information is on their Whois record that we could use? How about we look for, the problem is, say if they have like a GoDaddy one or, you know, Rackspace or something like that, we're going to get a whole bunch of crap we don't really want. So how about their email address, right? So this is registered with hp.domains@hp.com. And here's the phone number that was registered. Well, webbor.com has a sweet lookup, where you could look up domains based on the register's contact name, the register's contact email, or their phone number. So if I just plug in my hp.domains@hp.com, we get 2,111 domains. Now that sounds like some good recon for me, but I, again, do not want to go through all of these pages and have to copy and paste or pay to use their API to get this information from them. So we have a script for this one as well, and it's very similar to the other ones, but just want to give you an idea of this. So webbor scraper, and we have one argument, email. So let's go ahead and push this through. Python webbor scraper, email, and hp.domains@hp.com. Let that run. This isn't edited. This is how long it took, really. Actually, now it's going to be long. Oh, there we go. Okay, so that's not long for 2,111 domain names. And you cross that, check that with the previous one. But the point is, now with a few simple scripts in a matter of minutes, we got tons of IP ranges. We got tons of domain names, and now we could use that to do some real stuff, to look into, you know, what services they have, what kind of websites are on those, etc. I don't want to get all the way out. Here we go. All right, so that brings us to LinkedIn, which is like the main part of our talk here. So LinkedIn is like the monster of business intelligence. They have so much data, and it's amazing what you could do. And so you could you get a lot, but the problem is that they don't want you to scrape their site. LinkedIn is very particular. They don't want to share that data with you. So they have some layers of protection that they put in, and I wouldn't really call it protection, because please. There were some obstacles. So what I did is I was doing some research on figuring out how to get this information off of LinkedIn, and these were some of the obstacles that came up. One, they have a third degree redaction. So that means if anybody outside of your network is either a third plus degree, and you just say you do a Google search looking for Danny at HP and you're not connected to me in any way, my profile is going to be redacted and it's going to be very short. You're just going to have some basic information. You're not going to see like a lot of my past experience and my skill set and those kinds of things. So that kind of comes into play when you're using an automated tool to try to scrape data. Because most of the time you're not maintaining a session, but that is something you can do. So the other thing they do is our traffic restrictions. So you have to watch it. You got to throttle. They'll terminate your sessions and they'll lock out your account. So, of course, we got to figure out how to get past these. The third degree redaction, it's actually really cool. They do a thing, if you do a search on their site, if you do a search like I did earlier for a company and say a sales title or something, what you don't see is that behind the scenes they kind of authorized like a one-time auth token for you to view that profile, and they threw it in the hyperlink. Okay, so that auth token is what's going to allow you to view that page. Otherwise, you won't be able to see these third-degree connections. So if we could capture that auth token, then we can use that in our scraping. All right, so now traffic restrictions, throttle, session termination, they'll randomly, there isn't like a said pattern to it, but sometimes they'll just terminate your session if you're doing too much. You'll see later, I wrote a function in there that's looking for a session termination. If they terminate it, it'll automatically just re-authenticate real quick and give you a new session cookie. So it just continues its flow with that without being interrupted. And the last one is account lockout. Now, figuring out the threshold for account lockout was interesting, because I think I had my test account locked maybe about 3 or 4 times. And I had to send a message in. It's not like a 5-minute lockout or something like that. I had to send a message in, and the first person wrote back, and they're like, you are not allowed to use third-party tools to scrape data off our site, and you need to send in your driver's license and birth certificate and, you know, all this stuff. I'm like, oh. So I sent in another request. Another person responds, and they're like, oh, did you happen to be using a public computer? And I'm like, ooh. I'm going to write back to this person. And I was like, yeah, you know, I was at the library, and I think I left my session open, and I think somebody, like, took over my session. And they're like, oh, don't worry about it. That happens. Here's a new password. We unlocked your account. You're good to go. I'm like, yes. And so that happened, like, 3 times. So it's not really – there's ways to get around that. But once you figure out that that point where you're not getting an account locked out, that's usually a good thing. You could, and what I've done too to avoid some of the traffic restrictions is I put a list of different proxies I could use. So, because they'll block just my IP address, and so if I logged into my account from a different IP, it'd be able to. So you could do a list of proxies, and I put that in the script into where it'll kind of cycle through them. But all the proxies I use were like free proxies, and they're really slow, and so I was like, I'll just throttle my traffic for now. But that was fun. So what I'm going to do, I was debating, let's do this. I'm not going to do my video. I'll just open up LinkedIn because I have the internet here. Okay, so if we do a search, and I showed this at the beginning for those of you who missed it, you could do a search. Let's say, let's look for Hewlett. Well, let's do HP Fortify on demand, okay? And we'll do security people. Okay, there's only 2, really? There's more than that. If I do a search here, so it's going to give us a list. I didn't type it in right. It's going to give us a list of people, and you'll see that if I click on them, up here we have, authentication type out of network, and here's your auth token. So that's the auth token that we want to steal to be able to view these full profiles. Now, what kind of data do we want to get off LinkedIn? There's tons of data, and what I targeted specifically for this tool was trying to extrapolate what somebody's network is. Because LinkedIn won't tell you, these are all the people that Jane is connected to. They may say you have some people in common. Oh, right here. that's me. You may have some people in common, but they're not going to tell you who their whole network is. So how can we get that? Because what if we were doing that scenario where, like, let's pick our competitor and we're going to target their salespeople and see who they're all connected to. And if they have a theme of common people they're connected to, maybe that's one of their clients. You know, so you could extrapolate data like that. Well, how can we do it? Well, there's a little feature that LinkedIn added in a while ago, which is awesome. Skills endorsements, right? So you could list skills and people can endorse you and say, yeah, that person has that skill. Well, now only people within your network can endorse you. So right here is data that is scrapable of people that are within their network. And Jane has a pretty poor profile. I know JR has probably a better one, hopefully. Okay, yeah, JR has more, okay? So now I could go scrape all these people and extrapolate, you know, here's a network that belongs to JR. And if I do this for 100 sales reps, I'm gonna have some good data to compare. So we went ahead and ran this tool. I'll do a demo first. So let's do, does anybody else have? Oh wait, let's do something fun, like Lockheed Martin or something. So let's do an advanced search, Lockheed Martin as the company, current, and let's say security. Okay. So we'll grab this, do a search. All right. So here's our results. Now I'm going to show you the tool, and I may try to zoom in here. So we could see it better. And I hate doing this window zoom, but we'll test it out. Okay, you guys see that?
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Okay, so let's do our LinkedIn. The first part is called Gatherer. So it's basically gonna gather all the profiles. We're gonna try to, oops, I should type it in right.
Python.
Oh, Python. I should get that right, come on. LinkedIn Gatherer. All right, so enter your search URL. I'll just paste that. The company name, it was Lockheed Martin, and an out file, I'll just do Lockheed people.csv, and it's going to go ahead and do this search for us. It got a new session, it authenticated, page one, 11 people, I might have reached my limit. They do this fun thing, yeah, Austin, you've reached the commercial use on this account. All right, let me do one thing.
What's Austin's last name?
Oh, I can't tell you. No, that's myth. All right, let me do something real quick. This makes it more secure. Okay. Oh. I'm gonna see if I could switch accounts here. Config. They locked in both of mine. Okay, we're going to work with the data we do have. Okay, so let's work with the data we do have. So we ran this. That was our search. I should still be able to do our profile. So let me zoom in again. And let's see how much data we have in the Lockheed people. Okay, we have 6 people. Let's go ahead and do it. So let's go ahead and run our gatherer, this is our profiler, okay? So the input file is gonna be my Lockheed people.csv, and an output will do Lockheed profiles.csv. All right, so what this is doing is it's getting the auth token for each person. Hopefully LinkedIn isn't blocking me. Okay, so we're gathering firewalls, found 5 people. Networking, found 15 people. Internet security, 3 people. This is for Donnie. And it's going on and on. It has a little bit of a timeout. So I may let this run while I demo some other information I have. So it does a 60-second timeout between each person so I don't get locked out. But this is what it does. So for Donnie, it went ahead and grabbed, first it logged in, and then it grabbed the auth token to be able to view her profile so we don't see this redacted profile. And now it's extracting all of the endorsements from her page. So now we're getting some good information. So what do we do with this data? Well, how about we open up Maltego, which is awesome. Oh, wait, real quick. What are some other recon suites? Anybody know any other recon tools? Do you guys use any recon tools? Ah, you're not allowed to answer. Anybody else? Okay. You get a volunteer. Who gets the alcohol? Raise your hand if you want alcohol. Okay, first over here. All right, there we go. I tried to get rid of those. Okay, so Maltego, I love. It's awesome because it has, especially the pro version, the free version kind of sucks. You have awesome transforms, which are their modules to do recon, but just the mapping is invaluable. So I'm going to go ahead and import the data from this LinkedIn. So I have a couple files, and I may pull some other ones off my VM too. Did I do HP profiles? Yeah, I'll stick with HP. All right, so let's do HP profiles. And so these are all our columns. I'm going ahead and assign this as a person. So if you've used Maltego, this probably all makes sense. If you haven't, you can map data to different kind of nodes, and it does different tasks based on what kind of node it is. So this was their skill. So I'll just go ahead and say this is like, there's different things we could do. Person, URL. I'll just do an affiliation, I guess. And then, so this is another person. I'll do them as a person as well. I like doing the affiliations. And then this is their title and their company. Actually, yeah, what I'll do is not unmap this column. I may do their company because I want to see who these people are connected to as far as companies. Application security expert. Okay, here's the companies. So here we go. All right, we'll import this data. And it works its magic. We get to switch to bubble view, organic. All right, so it makes these really cool graphs, which even if you don't get anything out of them, they look cool, and you like make them as your wallpaper, and you're set. But if we look at the data here, so we have, let me zoom in. So the orange are our original people. So the orange people are our FOD, and all the green things are the things that they're associated with. So the bigger the circle, the more people are associated to it. And this is probably a blank item, so I usually delete that. Okay, so now we could look at things and say, okay, HP Fortify on Demand, we know that they're going to be connected to that. Troubleshooting, these are like different skills. But I could go ahead and see who's all selected for networking. So now I could see under troubleshooting, all these people are connected. But what I'll do, I wanted to do it actually without the skill data. So I'll import this again. HP profiles. I may do, a person and their affiliation as their skill. Okay. And you could do endless combinations. I'm just showing a few here. But I just want to get an idea of what kind of stuff we have out there. All right, so now this is skill sets. Okay, so now we have people who work at Fortify on Demand and their skill sets they have in common. So if I look at this one, testing. So we know those people have testing. These people have project management. Well, what if one of these said, like, Burp Suite, which one of them may. Well, now we could see, you know, okay, well, HP Fortify on Demand uses Burp Suite for their testing, which isn't really that unheard of. But let's say we did the tech company for Lockheed Martin, and they have, like, Barracuda firewalls. Okay, well, maybe all these security IT people are working with firewalls at Lockheed Martin that are from Barracuda. You know, we could get that kind of data. Well, let's do this. I'm going to import one more file. This is going to be, these are salespeople. And let's see. Let's do a person. Oh, I did the wrong profile. Did I do profiles? Oh, sucks people. Okay, let's actually grab our LinkedIn one because it's probably done. Okay, yeah, so we have our Lockheed Martin. Let me pull that file down. Lockheed Martin profiles. Make sure it's there. Yes, it is. Okay, so we'll go ahead and import our Lockheed Martin profiles. So here's all of our, we did IT, is that right?
Sales.
We did sales.
Security, sorry.
Okay. Well, we'll still do affiliation. So these people. Finish. Okay, so we have different graphs here. Okay, so get rid of our blank record here. All right, so let's look at this data. Here we have, there's not a lot of overlap between these people, surprisingly. We have one. That's not very exciting. So Joyce is connected to these other people, which unfortunately that wasn't as exciting as I really wanted it to be. But let's see here. Okay, then we will do this. Lockheed Martin. We have a person. Oops. All right. We'll grab their alias. And then, yeah, we'll do this one. Okay, so now we see a little bit more trends here. So this is our sale. These are our tech people from Lockheed Martin and the different skills that they have in common. So another way we could look at this is we could sort by weight to see which ones have the most. Can you guys still see this or do I need to zoom in?
Wouldn't hurt to zoom in.
All right, let's zoom in a little. Or income in is what I want. Okay, so here we go. Here's all the skills that they have the most common together. So they have network security, information security, NIST, etc. And so we basically got their skill set from their profile, and that's what I was getting here. So this is where we'd see, like, okay, well, if they have something in common, look, they all have VMware experience. Again, that's not a big given, or that's not a big surprise. But let's say, you know, we could say that a lot of security people at Lockheed Martin are using VMware. Now you could use their imagination to see how that could lead to more and more information that you could get. And we only got to do like six people from Lockheed Martin. But if we have a Salesforce team of 100 people, we download all of their data, all of their connections, and we could see who's connected to who. This person is like, we have 10 different salespeople that are all connected to ExcelEnergy.com. Well, okay, I guess that company is most likely doing business with ExcelEnergy.com. So that's where a lot of this data kind of comes into play and becomes useful. And now we've bypassed a lot of LinkedIn's protection in order to gain data from their sites. And what we take from their site is really unlimited. It's just basically, what can we find and how do we want to use it? And in this case, it was their extended network and their skills. But it really could be anything else. So I went ahead and took the code and put it up on GitHub here. So if anybody is interested in it, you could go ahead and get it. It's just called LinkedIn Gatherer. If you do a search, that'll come up. And don't look at this and be like, oh my gosh, this code is so sloppy, because it probably is. But it is a work in progress, and I'm gonna be expanding on it. But if you have any things you wanna do, feel free to pull or do any contributes to it or issue requests and stuff. So that's it. That's the presentation. Any questions?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You said you were going to do some. First off, this is awesome. And kudos for doing it live. Like, seriously. I don't know that I have that in you. But the question I have is, moving forward, have you thought about, I'm sure you have, but have you thought about doing an automated footprint? So that kind of what you were talking about, but turning it into a report, like, here's the target and here's the heat map of known technology. These are all associated with firewalls. And these are brands. I see that that's using the endorsements, but what about the people's profiles where it's like, I have experience in Cisco firewalls and Checkpoint.
And it's and it's just a matter of what you're pulling off of the LinkedIn profile, right? So if you get that data, then yeah, you could throw that into your map and get that heat map. And unfortunately, the data I had wasn't as big as I wanted it to be because LinkedIn throttled my account right there at the end. But yes, you can. And it's what I do a little bit more for my job is doing like fingerprints of companies, like the steps we're talking about, getting IP addresses, getting domain names through DNS, fingerprinting those, and getting all that together, throwing it into Maltego, get this huge heat map, and build this report for a client. Be like, hey, here's all the stuff we found. You know, that's a very powerful, you know, way you could use it. And on top of it, you could say, here's your sales force, and we found all this kind of information. Or here's your IT team, and we found this kind of information. And you could use now you could use the LinkedIn scraper to pull all this data off. Where before it wasn't so easy. They've made a lot of changes to make it hard, and I'm sure they'll continue to change it. But yeah, you really could get any information you want from those profiles.
Very cool.
Yeah.
You can scrape the whole profile. You've decided.
Oh, yeah.
A subset.
Yeah.
So to answer your question, I mean.
Yeah, you could. You could pull, because I'm getting an HTML response, right? And it has their full profile. And LinkedIn is very nice to where they actually, you don't have to do a lot of scraping because they take the whole profile and they load it into a JSON dump and it's like commented out. So if you view source, there's this like commented out JSON dump and you're just like, oh, I'll regex match that and now just consume the JSON object and it's all sorted in a pretty object. You know, you don't have to do a lot of scraping. So it's really neat how they ended up doing that for us. But yeah, you could grab anything. You could grab that whole JSON dump, save it, and then later access whatever data you want. Yeah.
Have you, like, when the company receives this information, do you know what they do with it afterwards?
A lot of times, well, let's say I work for Fortify On Demand, so we do pen testing. So a lot of times it may be like, here, we're giving you a huge... Or they're saying, here's all the assets we found that maybe you didn't know about, or maybe you did. Here's the technologies we found. Here's, you know, some profiles, some information that we found, and put it all in this report. And it's like, okay, how much business you want to do? You know, it could be a sales pitch, or it could be, you know, just to help somebody's security posture. You know, an established client to be like, hey, you're already a client of ours, but let's go ahead and like check your security posture. Do you know about these applications? Do you know this data is on LinkedIn? Are your employees aware that this information is on LinkedIn so that they're protected from, you know, social engineering kind of attacks? So,
job applications. Do you go to sites other than LinkedIn and look at the last 5 jobs? This is what he's done in all these locations.
Yeah.
This is the hardware they've been using.
Uh-huh.
He's not even an employee anymore.
Yeah.
But every place he's been, you see what hardware.
But you know. So you could be like, okay, we know this technology belongs to this client. Okay, that helps us a little bit more.
Or we're looking to hire somebody who manages XYZ software.
Uh-huh.
And it's all right there.
Yeah. That's great. Anybody else? Yeah. Like without violating terms of service? how to be a savvy user of LinkedIn?
Don't get straight, in other words.
Huh?
So poison your resume, perhaps?
Oh. Oh, okay. Okay.
It's kind of beneficial. You might get a better job.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. It depends. I mean, you need to be aware of what information you have on your profile and how that could be used against you. I think that would be fair to say. You could poison it. That'd be interesting. Yeah. Is that an answer, or were you asking something different? Were you asking how to get data off of LinkedIn, or how, as a user, to protect yourself from. Yeah. Oh yeah. So if you're actually wanting to get a job, like using LinkedIn for what it's made for.
Right.
Okay.
But on the other hand, you might want to leave your what you do blank.
Yeah, I mean, I have a full profile. I'm aware of the information that's out there, because it is a great tool for being recruited if you're looking for a job, and having it up to date and having more information is going to make you more likely found by the recruiter. And by the way, those recruiter accounts are amazing. If you're willing to push out the money for those, the data like exceeds what you can do with this, you know, 100 times fold. Plus, if you start scraping the recruiter account, then it's awesome. So, yeah. Uh-huh.
Have you scraped your recruiter account?
No. No, I have not. I haven't dished out the money yet or asked my employer to. But I'd like to. If anybody has one they want to donate, I'll test it out. What's that? I do. Actually, I think I do. Yeah, we'll talk after. So anything else? Okay. Well, thanks, guys. That's the talk. Thank you, B-Sides volunteers and everything. So. I need to put those other three on there for ARIN, GWeb, and WebBoar.
We can pull down.
Yeah.
And
they're
our,
all.
Our friend Bubba, remember him? He's a recruiter.
Yeah.
My friend Bubba. You'll remember him.
We all remember him.
Exactly. We'll bring him by the office. He looks a lot like him.
Yeah.
Bubba has a recruiter account.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's
been on for
the closing ceremony is going to be in here, so if you want to stick around and find out.
Really?
Really?
Oh, yeah, no, I like how you
have
the little things, like be prepared for not having the internet or video.
And I'm looking, I'm like, man, he's just clicking through that so smooth. And I look at your hands, I'm like, you cheeky bastard.
Maybe.
You totally said that.
And then you jumped into the line. No, solid, rock
cool,
solid.
Thanks,
I can't
man.
Think of a single way around that.
I wish.
It's like, what do you do?
Yeah.
Like, I can't not have a resume online.
Oh, yeah.
I got to be gainfully employed.